Man, I like the energy. We are fired up. Hey, did anybody?
There we go. There we go. My mic's working now. Sorry.
Hey, I think I asked like 90% of y'all. Did any of y'all freestyle in the golf cart?
Anybody? We have a dinosaur.
We got a
hey, Blake.
Hey, my
Blake
boy in the back.
Blake
there.
Freestyled. Hey, Max freestyled. Few people freestyle.
Hey, I just be writing lyrics down, thinking about it, because
next week,
we're going to hit it hard. All right, just be prepared for that.
We want y'all to freestyle. Hey, guys, welcome to Boathouse. Who's hyped for tonight? Come on. Woo! Let's go. It is an awesome night tonight. I'm so excited to be here. My name's Braden.
Hey, I'm Clay, and we want to welcome you. If this is your first time here, man, you are loved. You are welcome. And, man, come here and be yourself. Like, we are so excited that we can come to a place, love on each other. But, man, we're about to do some super cool stuff, man.
Yeah.
What do we do? Man, first thing we got to do is a giveaway.
Oh, the
right,
giveaway.
Let's hit the giveaway. If you got your ticket, let's get it. Let's get a drum roll.
Just so y'all know, we're giving away.
Hey, we got an Andy's gift card. Come on now, Andy's gift card.
We need complete silence.
All right, if you're a regular, you know the rules. Nine, four, one, six, eight, seven. We got a winner?
Anyone? No?
Hey! All right, we got a winner.
Let's
there
go.
We go. Andy's
hey,
gift card.
You gotta check.
We gotta check it. Man, it's legit. It's legit. She crushed it.
Congratulations. Here you go.
Hey, guys, so a couple things. I don't know if you've seen on Instagram, but we have East Texas Giving Day.
What is that?
Man, that's been, like, going on where people in East Texas just...
Is there a slide for that?
There we go. Okay. Man, hey, if you guys don't mind, man, put the word out. Let your parents, grandparents, friends, family, let them know, like, what God's doing here at Boathouse, because we have some really, really big plans. We're super excited for it, and this is an awesome way to support and just keep going and, man, let God do his thing here.
Absolutely. So, speaking on support, anybody eat dinner tonight? Anybody eat some hot dogs, anything, chips, anything like that?
Woo!
Hey, give it a round of applause for Cross Brand Cowboy Church.
My goodness. Hey,
I'm struggling.
Yeah,
to
so
talk
so
tonight.
Not Cross Brand, man. They have given over and over and over. Man, they provide food, seems like once a month for us. So it's super, super cool they do that. As well as we have a bunch of really cool churches. Central, Grace, Green Acres. Man, hey, get plugged in on Sundays to one of these churches that are coming out here and they're supporting Boathouse. If you don't have a church home, man, go support them and be there. And, man, God's moving at those churches as well.
Mm. Yeah. Heard that.
Love it.
Anything else? Any other announcements?
So tonight, if you are signed up to be baptized, we have a meeting upstairs after this. So be sure to stick around if you didn't check your email. And we're just a quick little meeting to go over a few things. So if you did sign up for that, don't forget that.
Yeah, I'm going to pray for us real quick and then we're going to get started. Bow y'all's heads. Father, thank you for tonight, God. Thank you for bringing all of us here this evening in such beautiful weather, Lord, getting to enjoy your sunset. Lord, I thank you for all that you're doing in our lives, God. I pray for this time just be restful, God. I pray that your spirit would be working in our hearts tonight, God. We love you. We need you. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. 'Cause you found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh,
sing it with me.
'Cause you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. It's a sign that you are with me. The fire by night guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Sing that again. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, you stepped in. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom, straight into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. So the God who fights for me, Lord, into my Egypt, you took me by the hand, you marched me out in freedom, into the promised land. Now I will not forget you, God, I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of you. Come on, make some first breath, running into your arms is running to life from death. So I'll run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again. I'll run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done. My soul found a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Whoa, 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 again and again.
Exactly how I feel, I can't begin to tell you what your love has meant. I'm lost for words. Is there a way to show the passion in my heart? Can I express how truly great I think you are, my dearest friend? And this is my desire, to pour my love on you, like oil upon your feet, like wine filled a dream, like water. Mine on you to
Heavenly Father, we love you. Thank you for bringing us together here tonight. Father, I don't know why, but I feel impressed to say that there's somebody here who feels like the prodigal son, who they've gone to a distant land and they have nothing else and they want to come back. Would you let them know tonight that you're going to run right after them and you're going to embrace them and you're going to say, my beloved, because that's who you are, that's what you do. So Father, as Isaac preaches, would you give us ears to hear and eyes to see of your goodness and your mercy. And Father, whatever things that we need to maybe lay down tonight, whatever branches you need to trim, you go ahead. Do what you want to do. Use this time for your glory and your glory alone. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Everyone said.
Check, check, check.
I did. It was great.
Check, check, check. Can you hear me? Check, one, two. There we go. Here it is. We're coming through now. How you guys doing? How's everybody doing tonight? Let's go. Hey, if you've got a Bible, go ahead and take that out. If you've got a phone or a Bible with you, take that out. Really quickly, as we're settling in to our nice, comfortable, concrete 2x2 spot that you get, can we give it up for the worship team and how they do? So tonight, we are talking about worship. And so I'm just really thankful for what the worship team does. And so I just want to give them a quick shout out. But odds are that when I say that word worship, maybe a bunch of different things come to your mind, but at least one thing comes to your mind, and that's singing, right? Or at least music. And you wouldn't be wrong in that. Like, that is not, you're not wrong in that. Without a doubt, that is one of the channels through which we worship. But it's not the only one. And I feel like the word worship has become so trivialized that it's almost, like, unhelpful to define what it is that we're doing. And so worship is not just like Christian karaoke, you know what I mean? Like, you don't just get together and like, yeah, put the projector on and like, let's sing some songs, some love songs to Jesus. Like, that's not at all, you know, what like all of worship is. And so tonight, with the few minutes that we have together, in light of the resurrection of Jesus that we just celebrated, which he is risen. Thank you. Let's go. Yes, he is risen indeed. In light of the most history-changing event that has ever happened, let's talk about what it looks like to worship. Let's talk about what it looks like, how the scripture talks about worship, how the biblical authors thought about the idea of worship, and for us to reclaim the fact that our entire lives are an act of worship. And so that's what we're going to do tonight. So if you have your Bible, go to 2 Samuel chapter 6. We're going to be Old Testament. And I want us to look at this story from the life of David, of what it means for us to live out a life of worship. Now, this doesn't mean this. It doesn't mean that you won't face setbacks. It doesn't mean that you won't face doubts or that we won't suffer consequences. But it does mean this, that if we can understand what worship truly is, a reverence and an adoration and love towards a perfect and holy God who is our Father and our Savior and our friend, then I'm confident that the setbacks and the doubts and the consequences will not hold back the church of Jesus Christ. And so if you have your Bible, again, 2 Samuel chapter 6, we'll have it on the screen. I want you to go there. Before I do that, I want to read this verse in Romans, in the book of Romans in chapter, chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. I'm a little scatterbrained. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. This is going to serve as our jumping off point for tonight. Here's what it says. Paul speaking to the church. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Now, jump with me to 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1. Here's what it says. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him to Baal Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who sits enthroned on the cherubim. And they carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, and Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the Ark of God, and Ahio went before the Ark. And David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. And when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah put out his hand to the Ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error. And he died there beside the Ark of God. Verse 8, and David was angry because the Lord had broken out against Uzzah, and the place is called Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day. And he said, how can the Ark of the Lord come to me? So David was not willing to take the Ark of the Lord into the city of David, but David took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the Ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, the Lord has blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that belongs to him because of the Ark of God. And so David went and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the Ark of the Lord had gone 6 steps, he sacrificed an ox and a fattened animal. And David danced before the Lord with all of his might. And David was wearing a linen ephod. And so David and all of the house of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouting and the sound of the horn. Verse 16. As the Ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought in the Ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And when David had finished offering the burnt offerings and the peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts and distributed among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, both men and women, a cake of bread, a portion of meat, a cake of raisins, gross, to each one. I just wanted to see if y'all are listening. Then all the people departed, each to his house. Verse 20, we're almost done. And David returned to bless his household. But Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, how the king of Israel honored himself today, uncovering himself today before the eyes of his servants, female servants, as one of the vulgar fellows shamelessly uncovers himself. And David said to Michal, it was before the Lord who chose me above your father and above all of his house to appoint me as prince over Israel, the people of the Lord. And I will celebrate before the Lord. I will make myself yet more contemptible than this, and I will be abased in your eyes. But by the female servants of whom you have spoken, by them I shall be held in honor. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no child to the day of her death. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time to come together and look at your word and look at what it means for us to worship. Father, I want to ask for your help right now. I want to ask for the Holy Spirit to come into this place and soften our hearts, to open up our ears and our minds to what your word has to say, Father. And I want to pray for a special prayer of help as we dive into this text. Lord, be with us tonight and help us to look upon you as the sole object of our worship. We ask this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Okay, I'm not going to pretend that that wasn't a long text full of weird names, confusing things, and like, that was weird, right? Like, that's a weird text. Like, you're like, you probably could have picked a better one, you know what I mean? But I really feel, I felt God impress upon my heart this passage, because we're going to look at the life of David for an example on how we ought to live our lives in reverence and in worship. And so I'm a really bad driver. I'm bad with directions. I'm bad just in general. Don't put me behind the wheel of a car. And so if you're like me, you know, great. But for me, what really helps is like a roadmap of where I'm going. And so tonight, as we look at this text, sort of a roadmap of three stops we'll make as we go through the text is this. Worship when it doesn't make sense. Worship like no one is watching. And worship in spite of the consequences. So that's kind of what we'll be covering tonight. And so looking back at verse 5, starting in verse 5, David is walking on cloud 9, right? The context of this is that David has just been elected to be the new king over Israel. He's got 30,000 of his closest friends and buddies who just defeated the Philistines, which Philistines, good guys or bad guys? Bad guys, thank you. Bad guys, really, really bad guys. And they're bringing back the Ark of the Covenant where God's presence is literally sitting on. And so David and his buddies are on cloud 9. And when I try to think about what it looks like for them to be bringing back this Ark, I think about something that happened this last year, which was the World Cup. Anybody care about that at all? Okay, sick. You never know, so I had to ask. And so Argentina won, if you didn't know this, you know, update, yeah. And they beat France, and upon them winning last year, they get to come home and do this tour. And so I have a picture of what downtown Buenos Aires, Argentina looks like when they, 4 million people. Think about that in your mind. 4 million people crowded into this one location, shouted, cheering. Some of you are stressed out. I can tell. You're stressed out in this room. And then you're like, yeah, that's how we feel right now. And in the middle of that, right, is Messi, and he's got the World Cup, and it's just so symbolic for them, all this stuff. Now, I want you to kind of take a glimpse of this and think of David as Messi in the middle, holding the Ark of the Covenant, coming back to the people, and everything is going great. You can take that down. It's stressing me out to look at it. So that's David, right? This is his moment. This is what everything has been building up to. He's the king. He's got his buddies. He's got the Ark of the Covenant. And then something unexpected and unplanned and terrible happens. Look at verse 5. David and all of the house of Israel, they're celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. And when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, in verse 6, Uzzah put out his hand to the Ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. Verse 7, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error, and he died there besides the Ark of God. And David was angry because the Lord had broken out against him. And that place is called Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day. And he said, how can the Ark of the Lord come to me? And so David was not willing to take the Ark of the Lord into the city of David. But David took it aside and took it to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. So things couldn't be better. And then some dumb cow trips. Uzzah is like, I got this, guys. He reaches for the Ark and lights out. What does this have to do with worship? You know what I mean? Like, we're, whatever. If you really want to get into the complexities of what's happening here, is that from one perspective, is that the Ark of the Covenant is not being honored. There's a very specific way that you can go and geek out on and read about how the Ark of the Covenant is supposed to travel, and they're not doing that. And so God is holy, and you can't be in his presence because he is so holy that his holiness would consume you. And so when Uzzah reaches for the ark, he has consumed himself. And so that's part of what's happening here. But from David's perspective, from what's happening here, is everything was going great, and all of a sudden it's not. Things are not going the way anyone expected. And notice David's heart. It's very much like ours today. It says that three things happened to David. David was angry, David was afraid, and David was unwilling. And maybe you walked into this place tonight and that's your story. Maybe you walked into this place and you're angry because God did something or he didn't do something in your life that you were expecting him to. And maybe you're in this place tonight and you're afraid that God's not listening or that he's not real, and you've harvested bitterness or apathy because you think your prayers aren't getting to him. Maybe you've never vocalized it or said it out loud, but you've internalized this to the point that you're like David. You know, you as a result of your experiences in life, you're unwilling to move forward with your relationship with God. And I don't want to speak that over anybody, but I just, in a room this size with all of these people, this very well could be your story tonight. And so you're sitting here and you're thinking, okay, but how does that lead me to worship? How does that lead me to live a life of worship? And this isn't a fantastic answer, but it's the only answer I have. Because maybe you're here and you're in this headspace. You're in this headspace that life is terrible and it's challenging and it affects you in so many different ways. And now I'm supposed to worship? Like, how does those two things connect? Maybe you're tempted to be like David, and this is a very popular thing going on right now, and you want to step away from your faith for a season, and you want to deconstruct, and you want to look at your faith from an outside perspective, but you don't want anything to do with it. And if that's you today, I just want to say I'm sorry, and thank you for being here. Thank you for not giving up. Thank you for trusting in the word of God and what he can do in your life. But I want to say this. Drawn away from God will never lead you to the answers that you're looking for. It says in James chapter 4, verse 8, that if we draw near to him, he'll draw near to us. And that drawing near to God will always lead to our blessing. And so students, if you're here tonight and you're in one of those three places where you're angry, you're bitter, you're sad, or you're unwilling to go forward with your faith, don't walk away. Don't let go. Draw near to him, because he wants you to come home, like Brandon was saying, like the prodigal son, come home. He's already waiting with his arms open for you to come back to him. Drawing near to God will always lead to blessing. Look at what happens in verse 10. All right, so David was not willing to take the ark of the Lord into the city of David, but instead he put it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And in verse 11 it says that the ark of the Lord remained in the house for 3 months, and the Lord blessed it and everyone in his household. Why? Because nearness to God leads to blessing. David leaves the ark with his family for 3 months, and guess what? They start to immediately be blessed by the presence of God. And so David returns, and he takes the ark with him, and it says at the end of the verses we read that he is rejoicing. That God, because David has drawn back near to him, is restored. And he is now rejoicing in his restoration. Because true joy is found in the presence of God. We talked a little bit about that a couple of weeks ago. And so here's the thing. Sometimes it's not going to make sense. Sometimes worship, whether it's through singing and music and coming to Boathouse and reading scripture and praying and fellowship with friends, sometimes that worship is going to feel like the last thing you want to do. But remember this, students, that when we draw near to God, he draws near to us, and we are blessed because of it. We receive the blessing of being in his presence and receiving his goodness. And sometimes we have to just worship through the doubt, worship through the bitterness and through the anger to see that in our suffering, God doesn't abandon us. Worship like it doesn't make sense. And so David also teaches us that sometimes we have to worship like if nobody was watching. So go with me to verse 13. It says this, "And when those who bore the ark of the Lord had gone 6 steps, he sacrificed an ox and a fattened animal." Verse 14, "And David danced before the Lord with all of his might. And David was wearing a linen ephod. And so David and all of the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the horn. How we worship matters. And I'm not talking about the only time when the music is playing and the lights are low and, you know, you're doing like the carrying the TV, you know, thing, and flat screen, you know, or the Mufasa, you know, whatever. Tim Hawkins, yeah, okay. Cheesy, but accurate. That's not what I'm talking about, although that is an expression of how we worship. In verse 14, it says that David danced with all of his might in his priestly gown, in his ephod. Basically, not the clothes that the king should wear, but the clothes that, like, the priests wore. Basically, the clothes that, like, nobody else should be wearing. In verse 16, it says that he was leaping and dancing. Right, maybe you've heard the story before, but I've always pictured this king leading this incredible procession of him leaping and dancing before the Lord. And so our obedience to Jesus and how we live our lives is worship. I'll say that again. Our obedience to Jesus and how we live our lives is worship. Because did you know that in all of Scripture, the first time the word worship is ever said, it has nothing to do with singing. The first time worship is mentioned in Scripture has everything to do with obedience. See, God is has this beautiful relationship with a man named Abraham. And Abraham's not very trustworthy, but God is very trustworthy. And God asks Abraham, "Abraham, take your son, your only son, your son whom you love, take him up to the mountain and sacrifice him." And it says that Abraham woke up early the next day and he took with him some people and he took the boy. And it says that he took the knife and the rope and the fire. And they get to a certain point and he says, "Hey, me and the boy are going up to the mountain to worship." What was his worship? Sacrifice. The first time worship is ever mentioned in all of Scripture has everything to do with obedience. So why would we think that that doesn't apply to our lives? God is calling us to obey him and to follow him. That is an act of worship. That's why we started off in Romans chapter 12, because all of our lives, our obedience and our followership to Jesus is an act of worship. And I think we forget that. Our worship is going to cause us to look different. And sometimes we have to be willing to stand out in our worship and in our obedience. It's going to look different and weird to the people around us. Because you know what? It looks different and weird right now. There's no reason in the world why 300 college students pack this place week after week and sit on the floor of concrete floor, read some ancient book about some man who lived a long time ago. But it's through your obedience, through your worship, Boathouse, that people are coming, they're getting saved, they're getting baptized, and they're following Jesus. And it's moving people all around East Texas to follow Jesus. And I love this passage. It's so easy to read over this, but in verse 15 it says this. If you'll pull it up on the screen, it says, "David and all of the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and the sound of the horn." It says David and all of the house of Israel, meaning that he's leading people through his obedience. He has influenced the people around him to worship. And I wonder if we could do the same. I know that you guys are, and I know that it's happening all over this place. Do we have any nursing majors here? Probably not, right? Okay, yeah, a lot. I was a nursing major once, too, for one semester. Before I realized, this is hard, and, like, that's not what I'm about. And so I took one class, or maybe a couple classes in nursing. One of them was on the human psychology and all this stuff. And one of the things we learned about was how we tend to follow. We tend to follow movements. We tend to follow and be easily influenced. And so I want to show you a video. And I'm just going to give you a heads up. Right now, it's weird. Okay? Lane's probably going to have to, like, talk to me after this. And, like, probably going to get some emails. But it's a little weird. But I just want you to see the power of influence. The power of what it looks like for one person to be obedient or to be, maybe obedient is not the best case scenario in this, but for one person to be willing to stand out and to have an influence on others. Let's roll that video. You can turn it down a little bit. Okay, so this guy is dancing, right? This is at a concert or some sort of, whatever, you know? And he's vibing, you know? He's doing his thing. It's weird. I told you, it was weird. But there's another guy. Yeah, okay. And now, it's a little weird. I told you it was weird. But look, no one else. Everybody's walking by. People are just, you know, ignoring it. One person started recording it because they were like, this guy is a freak. This other guy is also a weirdo. Sorry, Lane. I know it's kind of weird. But just watch, okay? Just watch as these two bozos are making fools of themselves start something. Here's a third guy. Third guy, Jimsy. He looks like Jack Black, you know? Probably is. Oh, God. This might be the last time I do this. But okay, they're having fun. It's a blast. People are sitting, you know, notice the people. But look at what's happening. Look at what's happening. Minute and second after second, people are coming and they're joining and they were mocking. And you can't even tell where the first guy was. And I'll just tell you this right now, you haven't seen anything yet. People are sprinting to get there. Look at this. This is madness. Yeah, I know. Just, you know, forgive us, Father. But look at what's happening. One person was dancing. Look at this. People can't get there fast enough. People are running over each other trying to get there. Look at what's happened. One person. Yeah, I don't even know where this ends. I don't know. Like, eventually we'll start dancing and it's just going to get weird. Okay, take it away. I don't know what happens next. So just, yeah. Here's my point. One person was willing to look like a fool to let everybody know that this is okay, right? One person. And some of you, you're like that first dude. You're weird, man. But you're bold. You're bold as all get out. We need you. Us introverts, we need you guys. Yes. Some of you, you're like that second dude, okay? You're like, I'm down with this, you know, I'm going to show up. I want to be a part of this. But with each person that came, more and more kept coming. And I think about King David, and I think he was the one leading this. He was the one who was willing to take off his kingly clothes and look like a fool so that everybody else could follow God. And I wonder if we would do the same. David didn't care that he was the king. In fact, he took off his royal clothes. David didn't care that people were watching him. In fact, he led people to join him in following after God, Yahweh. David didn't care if people judged him. He danced with all of his might. I hope he didn't dance like that. But even if he did, right? Like, he created a space where people could come alongside him and worship. And it's through this act of obedience. Through this act of obedience. And so how you worship matters. David was restored and he rejoiced and he knew that God was good. So he wanted everyone else to know him. Are you standing out? Are you rejoicing because you've been restored? Are you living out your life in a way that might be weird to the people in the world around you, but in a way that's honoring and worshipful to God? And see, on the other side of us being ashamed or embarrassed or even inconvenienced, God is wanting to use our worship and our obedience to show others his goodness. And he wants to use you. He wants to use all of you. David worshiped like no one was watching, and I pray that we can do the same. And the last thing we learn from David's life about worship is that we need to worship despite the consequences. Jump with me to chapter 6, verse 20 in 2 Samuel. Here's what it says. So David returned to bless his household. But Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, "The king of Israel honored himself today, uncovering himself, today before the eyes of his servants, female servants, as one of the vulgar fellows shamelessly uncovers himself. And David said to Michael, it was before the Lord who chose me above your father and above all of his house to appoint me as prince over Israel, the people of the Lord. And I will celebrate before the Lord, and I will make myself even more contemptible than this, and I will be abased in your eyes. But by the female servants of whom you have spoken, by them I will be held in honor. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no child to the day of her day. Sometimes we have to be willing to stake a stand. In 1939, there was a man by the name of August Landmasser. And he lived in Germany at the time of World War II. And he was in a very public, very open relationship with a Jewish woman. In fact, he was so public about this relationship with him and this family that he created, they eventually had a daughter, that he was willing to go and face jail time because of his relationship to this lady. And he was working at a shipyard one day in 1936 at the height of World War III, or World War II, gosh, sorry, World War II. Yikes. When he was working at the shipyard, when one of the ships was done and it was time for it to sail and have its maiden voyage. And it's custom in this day that every person who worked at the shipyard and everybody who was around would salute this German ship in World War II. And we have a picture of that day. We have a picture of what happened. Everybody except for August Landmasser saluted the ship. And they say that when the time comes, and inevitably as followers of Jesus, that time will come, we need to be able to stand and be like August. We need to be resolute about our worship and our obedience to Jesus. When everybody else and the world around us is going a million miles the other way, we need to be anchored in the person of Jesus. And I think David understood that. Look with me at verse 20. David returned to his own home. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, oh, how the king of Israel honored himself today and covering himself before the eyes of his servants, females, as one of the vulgar fellows who shamelessly uncovers himself. You can hear the sharp, cutting sarcasm, criticism, and hatred that she tries to put on David. She's trying to shame him for what he's done. And I think that we, as followers of Jesus, we're going to face the same things. Why would you go out there every Tuesday night? It's so far away, and like it's a school night, and like gas is expensive. What? Y'all have been dating how long? And y'all haven't like done anything? You Christians, you guys are just so narrow-minded. Like, you get with the times, dude. Like, get your mind with the times. Like, it doesn't matter. Live your truth. Christians, you guys are so boring. All you do is follow rules, and like, you guys have no fun. This is why people hate you. I know, it's almost ridiculous, but that's what we're hearing out there. Every step that we take as we follow Jesus is a step further away from the world and closer to him. And every step that we take with Jesus is going to separate us more and more and more from the culture and the world around us. This is nothing. This is nothing compared to what our brothers and sisters in Christ are facing in Africa, in Asia, and in places where the gospel is illegal. But I love David's response. I love his heart in this moment. In verse 22, I will make myself even more contemptible in your eyes. Why? Because God is good. His goodness has followed me for the rest of my days. And because he has done something for me that I can't do for myself. And so maybe you walked into this place tonight and you are where David was at the beginning of this story. Maybe you're angry. Maybe you're bitter at God. Maybe you're unwilling to go forward in your relationship with Jesus because the things of this world, if you're just being honest, seem a little bit better and more comfortable than following this Jesus. But can I tell you something? Those wells won't satisfy. Those things of this world, they will not satisfy. Anybody have the Bible app on their phone? Yeah, I think a lot of you do. There's a verse from today, John chapter 6, verse 35. This is not on the notes, but just listen. It says, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will not hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst. See, this sounds convenient, and this sounds really nice. Never having to eat again, that'd be kind of cool. Never having to eat, drink, be great. But I don't think we realize what Jesus is saying. What he's saying is that he satisfies. Satisfies more than anything else in this world. And there's a story of Jesus talking to this woman at a well. Do you know the story? She's there at the time where nobody else was there because she was full of shame. Jesus says to her, I have something to give you that this well will never give you. And I think a lot of us are like that woman. We're going from well to well to well looking for something that will satisfy. Where your well is that you have a boy that you text and that you like it when he texts you back. Maybe your well is going to Target and buying a bunch of crap and swiping that credit card. It feels so good. Maybe your well is Outer Banks season 3 and you just binge that like crazy. Maybe your well is a website that you go to late at night when your roommates are gone. Maybe your well is a relationship or it's a playlist on your phone. I don't know what your well is, but I'm telling you right now, those wells will never satisfy. Again, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will not hunger. And whoever believes in me will never thirst. So why do we worship? We worship because Jesus is good. We worship because he did for us what we could never do for ourselves. We worship because he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he is risen and he's resurrected and he's alive inside of you and inside of me if you place your faith in him. That's why we worship. And so I don't know where you are today. I'm going to ask the band to come today to the front. How do you live out a life of worship? What does that mean? It means that you worship even when it doesn't make sense. Through the doubt, the confusion, the setbacks, the bitterness. If that's you tonight, like there's people here who want to talk to you. I'm here. I want to talk to you. Because nearness to God will always bring about blessing. And we worship like no one is watching. Because it doesn't matter what people say or what they think. What matters is what God says and what he thinks. The last thing is this, that we worship in spite of the consequences. You might have to lose some friends. You may get judged or criticized or have really ugly, ridiculous things said about you. But it doesn't matter. Because you have been accepted and loved by God, and that is all that matters. His goodness and his mercy is always chasing after you. And it chased you all the way to the cross. And your sins, the things that give you that guilt and that shame, were nailed to that cross. And they killed our Jesus, but he didn't stay dead. 3 days later, he came out triumphant for your sake and my sake. And now he holds the keys to the kingdom, to life and to death. And sin no longer has to rule over you. That's why I worship. That's why we go and we get so passionate about what God is doing here and in the lives of so many college students, because he's already done all the work. All we have to do is follow him. That's worship. Obedience and following after Jesus. Not because some 10 rules that we are just so strict about, but because he loves us, we obey. We don't obey so that he will love us. The other way around. So wherever you find yourself tonight, we're about to have an opportunity to worship through singing. And that video of that guy dancing was hilarious. But we're about to have an opportunity to sing out and to let God know that we're thankful for what he's done, that he is unlike anybody else on this planet, that he will satisfy. And so I'm just going to ask you, will you engage? Will you sing? Will you forget that there's anybody else in this room? Will you remember the sacrifice that Jesus did on your behalf? And if you're here today, and you say, I want to do that. I really want to believe. I really want to go forward with my relationship with Jesus, but I just don't think I can trust him. I just don't have all the answers. It's okay. There's people here in the deck who would love to talk to you about what it looks like to follow Jesus. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to pray for us, and then we're going to enter into a moment of worship. Lord, I'm just so thankful for today. I'm so thankful for your goodness and that you pursue us and that you are the bread of life and you satisfy. God, I pray for any student in this place who is going to from well to well to well looking for something that will satisfy. I pray that they would remember that Jesus is the bread of life, that he alone can satisfy. And Lord, as we enter into a moment of singing and worshiping, Lord, I pray that we would worship when it doesn't make sense. I pray that we would worship even though our lives are crumbling outside of this place. I pray that we would worship even if we're bitter. I pray that we would worship like no one else is watching but you, because you are. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I am a child.
Moment, I just want to remind you that you are welcomed in this place. I don't know what to do. Okay. All right. Clay's coming up. He's going to say some things, but we love you guys. Shout out, Clay.
Well, sorry about that. Brayden and I were trying to get the wireless mic going, but clearly we're getting some feedback there. So I just wanted to make an announcement about the baptisms. If you are signed up for that, will you meet myself and Max from Grace? We're going to be at that back bar, and then we'll gather together and roll upstairs and have a quick little meeting. So, man, thank you guys for coming. It was super cool. I mean, we packed the house tonight. We were all the way back to the bathrooms. Praise God. I mean, so... And I just want to leave you guys with, man, the feeling of worshiping and just shouting God's name, like, it doesn't have to stop right here. Like, I challenge you tomorrow, like, when you go out, whether you're at school, work, friends, man, let Jesus just overflow. Like, man, praise God. Super.
Accept us.